Shalom Akoti, my sister. Welcome back to another video. We're going to be diving more into the whole womanhood series with relationships, and particularly relationships with our men. And even if you want to get more specific, with our husbands, or if you have a boyfriend or your fiance. And then of course, as always, it can apply to any man in your life, whether that's your father, an elder, your boss, your coworker, anybody, brother, cousin, list goes on, right? So as always, I have my little notes here because I found that you guys really did kind of like having a more me being in front of you kind of personal touch to the presentation versus me actually having the presentation, you know, on PowerPoint like I do with the Mystery of Babylon and more faith biblical kind of studies. So I'm gonna keep it in this kind of setting. I'm trying to find different areas in my house depending on sunlight. So today, this is the best part of the area where are the apartment where I can actually you can actually see me. So before we start, as always, there is a Facebook group for the Dear Akoti YouTube channel where we can actually have more of a, I want to say, personal feeling almost together. So you guys can post and comment, and I can post and comment, and it's much more personal than just being on YouTube and me making a video and you responding to it. You know, you can start your own posts and ask questions, and so it's just really awesome to be able to have that kind of area to do that. And so, as you know, as we all continue to grow, we can lean on each other and encourage each other to grow and share things with each other that we learn. So link for that is going to be down in the description box. And then also, always a note is the names that I use, just for anybody who's new. Hello, if you are, my name is Shanae. Really, really nice to meet you. I use the name Yah and Yahuwah to refer to our God, our Father, our Creator, our Elohim. The list goes on. And so I want you to know who I am referring to when I do say that name, because I've gotten so used to saying that name all the time that I tend to say Yah or Yahuwah a lot more than I say God or anything like that. So I want you to know who I'm speaking about. And then with the Messiah, it's the same thing. I call him Yahusha, which is his Hebrew name. And again, I know that everybody pronounces his name and Yah's name differently, just depending on the person and what they've learned. But this is how I pronounce their both of their names. So Yahusha is the Messiah's name that I and the way that I pronounce it. And I just want you guys to be able to know who I'm talking about whenever I do talk about them. So yesterday we talked about love and the true definition of love according to the Hebraic perspective. And today we're really going to talk about the ideal woman from a man's perspective. And so we're going to pull in Proverbs 31, you know, everybody's favorite chapter, even though it's not really the whole chapter. It's maybe, I think, 20 verses or something. But everybody loves to talk about the Proverbs 31 woman and who she is and yada, yada, yada. But it's important to realize that Proverbs 31 was written from a man's perspective. It was not written from a woman's perspective. And so we as women have to kind of gear and shift our mindset toward, what does my man want from me as a woman? You know, what is the ideal woman from my man's perspective? So that's really what we're going to tackle today. So, like I said, the beginning to all of this is understanding that perspective that the men have and realizing that because they're men and they do think differently than we do, they expect different things from us than what we expect from another woman. So their ideas about being a woman are different from our ideas. The things they admire in a woman are completely different than what we tend to admire in another woman, you know, whether that's in friendship or just, you know, saying, oh, that's a really awesome woman, you know. And it's funny because it's usually the things that we look high upon that the men don't really care about, and then the things that they look high upon are the things that we almost kind of don't like about other women. So things that we as women are more inclined to appreciate in another woman would be things like talent, their intellectual gifts, having a really clever personality, the way that their body is shaped or the way that their face is shaped, you know, the shape of their nose and their eyes and things like that, or what clothes they're wearing or what beauty products they're using, or, you know, how they apply their makeup. Things like that are what we as women tend to focus on. And men, on the other hand, tend to admire things like being girlish, or being tender and sweet and kind and having energy and vivacity and having an awesome, like a sweet character. Having the ability to even understand men is a huge one. Things like the sparkle in our eyes or our smiles. I mean, I don't know if you've ever had a guy tell you, hey, smile. And then as women, we're immediately kind of turned off and we're like, don't tell me to smile. And you kind of frown, right? But the reason they're telling you to smile is because that's genuinely something that a man likes to see. They love to see the smile of a woman, the sparkle in her eye. They're not focused on, you know, the way her nose is shaped, or does she have the latest, you know, trends on as far as clothes? Does she have the latest purse or the latest shoes, you know? Or is her makeup on fleek? You know, none of the men care. They don't care about those things. They care about, well, oh, she has such a pretty smile. Look at her smiling. You can see the life inside of her. So we have to realize that men think differently than women when it comes to the ideal woman. And we need to honor what the man wants as far as his perspective of an ideal woman, because that's what he's looking for. We're not looking for a woman. We may be looking for friends, sure, and, you know, wanting friends who maybe have the same kind of sense of style as you. There's nothing wrong with that. But we have to realize that a man wants certain things in a woman, and we need to strive to be that for our man, because we are called to be the helpmeet or the helpmate. Which means we're supposed to be his teammate, his perfect partner. So we need to begin to focus on being that ideal woman for him. So we're going to go a bit deeper into who this ideal woman is, and we're going to refer to her as Angela Human. And there's a reason for this. So back in the 20s, there were actually little booklets that would go out teaching women how to be women. And this was around the time when you had the flappers kind of coming out and feminism rising and women really trying to be more like men. And this character of Angela Human was portrayed in these little booklets. And so we're going to call her Angela Human. All right. So I'm just going to kind of read straight from my notes here on who Angela Human is, or who this ideal woman is. And then we're going to actually compare her to the Proverbs 31 woman. So Angela understands men. She doesn't expect them to be perfect. She realizes that they're different. Their needs, desires, and temperaments differ a lot from women. She's happy within herself and projects that happiness to other people. She has a sense of peace and calmness that comes from a long-term effort on her part. So practice definitely makes perfect. She isn't this super calm person from birth. You know, it took practice, and obviously it took Yah and his Holy Spirit to really get her to a place of being that quiet, calm strength. She has a simple joy of being alive and shares that joy with everybody that she comes into contact with. She's as feminine as she can be. She looks feminine, dressing in a way that shows her femininity but also reflects her. And we're going to talk about what femininity is, not in this video but in another one. A lot of us always tend to feel like femininity is making us women be inferior, but we're going to talk about what it is and how we can appear more feminine, because it's not necessarily always what you think. She makes the most of her overall person and presentation of herself. She behaves femininely. She doesn't practice unflattering actions. Her personality is feminine, she's comfortable in her own skin, and she likes who she is. And since she accepts herself, it's much easier for her to accept others. She has an angelic character about her. So she has control over herself. She can resist temptations of selfishness, which again, we kind of learned about yesterday with the definition of love. I would definitely suggest you watch that video. It's in the playlist for relationships, but I'll try to remember to link it down below. Her word is gold, and she comes through on what she promises. She gives herself to her man, her children, her family, and her community. She's not perfect, but she doesn't participate in evil doings. She takes homemaking to an artistic level. She makes an art form out of her ordinary everyday work in her life. She enjoys and is grateful for her homemaking task, even the menial ones, even the dirty ones, because she loves the end result. She loves creating a comfortable home, a place that works perfect for the people who live there. she's healthy as she can be given her circumstances, and she realizes that perfect health isn't always achievable, especially as you age, but she does the best that she can to maintain and attain her best physical and mental health. And spiritually, she reflects, yeah, she follows Torah as best as she can. She's enthusiastic about her life training and the growth that she's going to receive. She understands the definition of love, which again, we talked about yesterday, the true definition of what love is, and that it means giving to someone, and it means following Torah and reflecting Torah, you know, in your outward life so that it reflects in that person's life as well, helping to elevate that person in Torah and obviously in the end become a reflection of Yah as well. So she understands the definition of love, and she sees others as herself, mirroring Torah to them, elevating them. She's a bit girlish. She's sweet, but she's spicy too. She's mischievous at times, but she's never mean. She gives herself to others, but she doesn't allow others to walk all over her and to really be mean to her and mistreat her. She stands up for herself and for others, but not in a way that hurts somebody else, because she reacts in a charming way. She's not reacting with sarcasm or nasty language or an ugly behavior, but with a feminine touch. Now, here's what I want to mention about Angela. She's the ideal woman, again, from the man's perspective. So keep this in mind. And remember that when we're talking about the man's perspective. So this woman, this Angela human woman, that if we were to meet her in real life, which many of us have met many Angelas in our life, right? We actually tend to get annoyed by her. We almost kind of feel like she's a little too perfect, and she's not the kind of woman we want to be around. But again, this whole video series is not about the kind of woman we want as a friend. It's about the kind of woman that most men would love to have as their wife. So keep that in mind and how you approach these videos. Don't approach them from the sense of, well, I wouldn't want to be friends with her. Well, that sounds like she's too perfect, or, you know, all of the different things that are going on in your mind right now. Remember to keep in mind that this is from the man's perspective, and that as women, our goal should be to be that helpmeet or that helpmate or that helper or that team player to really help lift up our husbands and to help him to lead. So in order to do that, we really have to make sure that we are the woman that he wants us to be. So this woman, Angela, can also be found in the Bible. And of course, there's many, many, many women who resemble the same exact qualities. And we'll talk about them as we go throughout the series, of course. But right now, we're going to focus on one woman in particular, a woman who her name isn't even mentioned. But she's called the Proverbs 31 woman that we all hear about, whether it's in church or wherever you want to call it, wherever you've heard it before. We've heard of this Proverbs 31 woman, or the virtuous woman. And quick side note here, I do have a whole blog post with a free audio download on the blog. So I'll be sure to link that specific post down below as well, and it goes all into what a virtuous woman is and what the word virtue actually means for a woman, because you'd be surprised, but a lot of us have a whole different idea of what virtuous means, and it actually has to do with being strong, being strength, having strength and being protective, and all these different things that encompass being a virtuous woman. So I'm going to link that down below, and I highly suggest that you watch it. Listen to it. And you, like I said, it's a downloadable audio that you can listen to. You can just play it. You can download it and play it later while you go for a walk or while you're at work, whatever works for you. Or you can simply read the post, because the post pretty much outlines exactly what the audio is speaking of. So I definitely would recommend that you go ahead and take a look at that post, because I'm not going to go deep into what a virtuous woman is today as far as what the word virtue means. We are going to go into her characteristics that are portrayed in the Proverbs 31 woman chapter. But again, so you can get a clear handle on what a virtuous woman is and what the word virtuous actually means, definitely go ahead and click that link down below. So let's talk about the Proverbs 31 woman. And we're really going to read from verse 10 all the way to verse 31 so that we can see how she is described. And we're going to, you know, every couple verses or every verse or so, we're going to kind of take a stop and we're going to reflect on it a little bit, and then that'll really be the video. So, starting with verse 10 through 11, and just in case you're wondering, I'm reading from the Scriptures translation for anybody who's wondering. So, who shall find a capable wife is what my translation says, but in most translations, well, some, it'll say virtuous woman. It depends on what translation you read, but I really love that it says, who shall find a capable wife? Because this means that it's not just any wife, because anybody can take on the title of being a wife, but are you a capable wife? Are you really fulfilling the role that Yah has laid out for us in his Torah and that he has laid out for us in his entire word? Because again, his entire word really just confirms what his Torah has stated as far as how we should live our lives. So, who shall find a capable wife? For she is far more than rubies. The heart of her husband shall trust her, and he has no lack of gain. So these two verses, this is verse 10 and 11, they're speaking of her character. She's trustworthy. She's worth far more than rubies. Her husband's heart shall trust her. So showing that she's a trustworthy person. And again, this is really just speaking of her overall character. Verse 12, she shall do him good and not evil all the days of her life. So again, speaking of her character, the fact that she understands men because she's doing him good and not evil. So she's understanding of what is good for him and what is evil for him. She is consistently good because it says all the days of her life. So she's not just good on some days, she's good every day. And again, this doesn't mean she's perfect, but it means she has an understanding of what her husband wants. She has an understanding of what Yah calls her to, and she fulfills that every day. Verse 13, she shall seek wool and flax, and with delight she works with her hands. So this is speaking of her homemaking skills, and specifically sewing. It's also showing that she's industrious. She can work with her hands. She's not afraid to get her hands dirty. Verse 14, she shall be as the ships of Tarshish. She brings in her food from afar. So again, referring to her homemaking skills, and specifically making meals in this case. It shows that she's conscious of health and nutrition because she is bringing food in from afar. She's not just getting whatever she can get. She's really picky, really, about what she's going to feed her family. Verse 15, she also rises while it is still night and provides food for her household and what is lawful for her girls. So, again, speaking of her character, showing that she's diligent, she's an early riser, she's not slothful. She gets up while it is still night to prepare food for her household. And I want to make note that it's not just physical food, it's spiritual food as well. So she knows that she not only wants to make sure that her family and her employees, you know, because at the time this is when, you know, women had servants and things like that. So she wants to make sure that everybody's well taken care of before they even get up in the morning. But beyond that, she also makes sure that she is prepared to spiritually feed them, to nourish them with words of encouragement and words of wisdom directly from Yah's word. So she's reflecting Yah's word and Torah. So again, this is still referring back to the same video that we did yesterday where it talks about what love is and that has to do with you reflecting Torah to someone else and giving of yourself to that person. Verse 16, she shall consider a field and buy it, and from her profits she shall plant a vineyard. So speaking of her responsibility and her being almost entrepreneurial and having her own business and just having that kind of business smarts to be able to go and buy real estate and to plant her own vineyard on it. You know, she's able to do that. And again, showing that she's not afraid to get her hands dirty. Verse 17, she shall gird herself with strength and strengthen her arms. So obviously this one's pretty straightforward, speaking of her health and her being physically fit. Verse 18, she shall taste when her gain is good. So speaking a little bit of her character here, showing her humility and having a correct opinion of herself. It's also showing that she's careful about what she purchases because she shall taste when her gain is good. So she knows when she's buying something that is good. She knows when she has something that is good. Her lamp does not go out by night. So this is showing her, one, her preparedness and homemaking and her health endurance. So for her being prepared, so remember back in the day they didn't have electricity or anything like that. So this is when you had to make sure you had enough oil for your lamps. And so she was highly prepared. And this is something that we like to focus on here on this channel, is being a prepared woman, a spiritual prepared woman, right? And also just showing that she does have some health endurance so that her light does not go out. Verse 19, she shall stretch out her hands to the distaff or the strong things, and her hand shall hold the spindle. So again, kind of showing her health here, because I don't know if you've ever spun yarn. I haven't, but I've seen videos showing really kind of like how they would have done it back then, and it can be a pretty moderate exercise. So one, showing that she's physically able to do these things, but two, her homemaking skills. She's not afraid to roll up her sleeves and do some work. Verse 20, she shall extend her hand to the poor, and she shall reach out her hands to the needy. So showing her character again, that she's not selfish, she's charitable, she gives generously to others. And I want to make a note here that this doesn't mean that she's giving to those who will take advantage of her. It says to the poor and the needy, so those who truly need her help. Verse 21, she is not afraid of snow for her household, for all her household is dressed in scarlet. So this is, again, speaking of her homemaking skills and her preparedness. She's not afraid of the winter to come or any change in weather because her family is prepared. They have the clothes that they need to be ready for any kind of weather. Verse 22, she shall make a tapestry for herself. She is dressed in fine linen and purple. So really speaking of her feminine looks here, because you have fine linen and purple. Some verses it says silk or satin. You know, so it's showing that she's elegant and modest because she's making a tapestry for herself. I don't know what you think of when you think of tapestry, but I don't really think of a skimpy little dress or anything. I think of something that's covering her whole body. So she's modest, and she realizes that there's four purposes to clothing. You know, you have the obvious meaning of it protecting us. It's a symbol of status, which is where you're really kind of seeing that color purple come in. Purple is really symbolizing royalty. And this doesn't mean that you're rich or anything as far as money goes, but you have a status of what kind of woman you are. It differentiates her gender, so she's dressed in fine linen and in purple, so she's dressing to really showcase her femininity. And then we also had modesty with it being a tapestry. Come on now, a tapestry, not a little black dress, but a tapestry. And obviously modesty is something we'll go into in another video, but she was modest. So verse 23, her husband is known or honorable in the gates when he sits among the elders of the land. So one, this is showing the pride of her man. He's able to walk through the streets and people know of him because of his wife being the virtuous wife that she is. She's a helper to her husband. He's a better man because of her. She's helping to uplift him. She's a helpmate, a team player. Verse 24, she shall make fine linen and sell them and shall give girdles for the merchants. Now I want to make a note here. She is not the merchant. She is providing something for the merchant. So there's we're going to have a video where we talk about the roles of men and women and the feminine and masculine roles. And one of the things is realizing certain jobs just really aren't for women. Now, yes, as women, we can do them. And this isn't to say that we're not strong enough to handle certain roles and different jobs and things like that. But it's just that Yah has ordained us and created us for certain roles as far as certain things that we cannot do as far as without drawing away from what our primary role is. So one of those things is not being a merchant. So our job is not necessarily to be the merchant. And you see that she was not a merchant. Yes, she was self-employed and she was an entrepreneur and she had her own business kind of going, but she was creating things and then selling them to that middleman. She wasn't selling directly to a customer. So that's something we would definitely want to make a note of. It's also showing that she cares of the family finances because she's making things and selling things to kind of help bring in some money. And also showing again that she's a businesswoman, she's self-employed. But this means that the job is not going to take over her life because, again, she is self-employed. She determines her hours. She determines what she's going to put forth into that business so that she can actually take most of her energy and put it into the role that she's been ordained to do. Verse 25, strength and splendor or beauty are her garments or clothing, and she rejoices in the time to come. So this is really showing her serenity, for one. So she rejoices in the time to come. So one, she's prepared for anything that is to come. And she has a serenity or calmness about her when it comes to that. She knows that whatever is Yah's will is going to happen, and she knows what most of Yah's will really is based off of the word and reading it herself and understanding it. And so she has a sense of calmness about her. She's not worried about what's going to happen in the future. And also, just speaking of her strength and her beauty or splendor, are her garments. So she is a strong woman. She is a beautiful woman. And this doesn't mean that she has to put on makeup or anything, but that she's just beautiful. She just radiates beauty. Verse 26, she shall open her mouth with wisdom, and on her tongue is the Torah of loving commitment. This, you guys, this is why, one, I love the scriptures when it comes to this particular verse, because it says that on her tongue is the Torah of loving commitment. So we literally just talked about this yesterday with what the definition of love is, and that it has to do with you giving, right? And, you know, one giving to two. So you giving, and more specifically, you living out, again, your life following after Torah, and seeing others as yourself, and seeing them as a reflection. So when you see them as a reflection, you're going to want to give your all to that person. You're going to want to instill as much of the Torah within that person as you can, because you're doing the same to yourself, and you're going to want to treat that person the same way that Torah tells you to treat that person. And so by doing that, you are then also helping them to reflect Torah and reflect Yah. And so just the fact that it says on her tongue is the Torah of loving commitment just shows that Torah is on her tongue. It's in her speech. It's who she is. So again, speaking of character, empathy, serenity, and following Yah, has wisdom, is a wise counsel, and is kind. Verse 27, she watches over the ways of her household and does not eat the bread of idleness. So again, showing that she's diligent, she's not slothful, she doesn't spend all of her time procrastinating. Again, she's probably not perfect. She has her days. She knows when to rest. Hence, she does honor the Sabbath and celebrate and observe it, because we all need our rest. And we're going to get into this in another video, talking about our menstruation and how Yah has really given that to us as a time to rest. So she knows when to rest, but she's not idle. So she's not going to just sit around all day on the couch and just sleep all day. She's not going to oversleep all the time. She's not going to be lazy. She's going to get her work done. But she watches over the ways of her household. So she's focused on her family. She's making sure her children are being raised in Torah and are being raised according to Yah's word. She's making sure that she's giving counsel to her husband, and she's honoring him and being submissive to him and honoring the divine order that Yah has put in place. She's responsible and, again, family focused. So verse 28 and 29 says, her children shall rise up and call her blessed. Her husband too, he praises her. Many daughters have done nobly, but you have risen over them all. So this is really just speaking of her overall in general. She is considered blessed. Her husband and her children, you know, they praise her. They are thankful for her, and that she has literally risen above all other women. This is showing the amount of gratitude that her family has for her, because she does so much, and showing that she is a respectable woman. Verse 30, loveliness is deceptive and prettiness is vain. A woman who fears Yah is to be praised. So really, just again, speaking of her overall character as a woman, it's not about being pretty, and it's not about beauty, physical beauty or anything like that. It's about walking in Yah's Torah. It's about walking that narrow path and being held accountable by Yah and fearing Yah. Verse 31, give her of the fruit of her hands and let her works praise her in the gates. So this is the last verse of Proverbs 31, and it's really speaking of the results of this woman being able to live out the life that Yah has ordained for her. So she is given the fruit of her hands and her works praise her in the gates. So by her following Torah, by her reflecting that in others and loving or giving to others, she receives the works of her labors. So now, walking away from this video, the last thing I want you to do is compare yourself to this woman, to this Proverbs 31 woman, or to this Angela human woman, and belittle or downplay yourself. That's not what we're here for. We all need some work, and we all need a little bit of shining and elbow grease. But right now, I want you to realize this: you're already partly there. You don't have to throw away everything that you are and everything that you do and start from scratch and rebuild yourself like a robot. You need to just start where you are. So one thing, one exercise that I found that actually kind of really helped is listing things that you like about yourself and having that list with you at all times, whether it's in your purse or on your phone, so that when you have days where you kind of feel like, man, I am not up to par with this Proverbs 31 woman, you can have something that kind of reminds you of the things that you do like about yourself, the qualities that you do have that you're starting out with, right? And then from there is where you start to build. Here is where you begin to say, okay, well, this is where I am and this is where the virtuous woman is. What do I have down and what is it that I need to work on? And then begin to work on those things that need a little bit of extra help. It's, again, not about starting over from scratch. It's about building on what you have. So here are the qualities of the ideal woman. I'm gonna go ahead and list them. So understands men, has inner happiness, has a worthy character, is a domestic queen, meaning she is a homemaking queen. She takes care of her house. She's feminine, she radiates happiness, she has radiant health, and she's childlike. And again, we're gonna talk about what childlike means. It doesn't mean that you're literally a child. It more so has to do with your girlish tendencies, things, ways that you can react to the man that really kind of offset having a whole war happen in the house. So ask yourself, out of these areas that I just listed, what areas do you really need to work on? Make note of the areas that you are pretty good in and put those to the side for now, and then begin to work on the ones that need your help. And we're going to be talking about all these areas in the next coming video, so don't worry about that. Don't feel overwhelmed like, man, I really don't know what I'm supposed to be doing with all of this. We're going to jump into all of that stuff. Understanding men, being happy, and, you know, having that inner peace and calm and happiness, having a worthy character, being, you know, a homemaking queen, being feminine, radiating happiness and health, and being childlike. We're going to talk about all these things and more, so don't worry about it. We're going to talk about it. But for now, take a moment and forgive yourself for the past woman you've been, because that's the number one thing that I always, that one I experience and one that I hear from other women who in general come to this walk and want to begin to honor Torah. One of the first things we as women go through is, man, I can't believe I acted this way, or I did this, or I did that. We begin to feel guilty and we condemn ourselves for how we acted in the past, and we can't live that way. Yes, you need to acknowledge your past and what you did, but you have to be able to move forward. You cannot get stuck on what you did in the past. So you have to say, okay, I acknowledge that I was that type of woman and I acknowledge that I messed up here, but I'm gonna go ahead and move forward now and have a plan of action on how I can become better and how I can act differently in the future. So one, forgive yourself, okay? Forgive yourself. You are in this new walk now. You know, Yah has forgiven you of your past. You're a new creature in Him and in His covenant with the Messiah, Yahusha. You are a new being, a new creature. So realize that that is part of the past and you need to let it go. Two, hold yourself accountable to Yah now. Realize that you're bringing your whole life under new management. You're bringing your life under His Torah, you know, under His, the Messiah that He sent, His Son, and under Him. So realizing that you're under new management, you don't have to do things the old way anymore. And then three, begin to do those new things. Begin to follow His ways, the ancient ways. So of course, the things that we're going to be talking about in the next coming videos, and any kind of little Torah Bible studies that you see on this channel, you know, begin to read His word. Literally, just open up your Bible and read His word, and begin like that, and begin to study His word, read His word out loud and meditate on it every day, and hang out with women, like-minded women who are trying to become that same spiritual prepared Proverbs 31 woman. Hang out with women like that who are going to give you wisdom and encouragement and counsel from Yah's word, and are going to help to teach you things that maybe you don't understand. That's why I've created the Dear Koti Facebook group. So again, shameless plug here, go ahead and click the link down below to join that group, because it's super, super important that we surround ourselves with like-minded women. There's way too many women out there who are walking this path alone and need the encouragement of having a tribe. So with that, my sisters, I thank you so much for watching this video. I hope that maybe you've learned a little bit more about this ideal woman from a man's perspective. From now, we're going to jump into all of these different areas of what a man expects from a woman and how we can kind of elevate ourselves to that level. We're going to talk about in the next video, specifically femininity, what it is, and the feminine appearance overall. So look forward to that in the next video. I will see you then. I love you and y'all bless you. Keep seeking ya, Maya Koti, my sister. See you in the next video. Bye.